Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, assalamu alaikum. I welcome you all to the lecture number 14 for the course of routing and switching. My name is Engineer Jafar Ali. I'm your instructor for this course. So this is the first part for the lecture number 14, and the topic of today's discussion will be DDR, or you can call it dial on demand routing. So let's get started. And let's have an overlook of the or and the brief of today's lecture. So inshallah, with the end of the session, you will be able to basically configure the DDR while giving a functioning remote access router and a physical ISDN connection. So this is basically a continuation of the previous lecture in which we discussed ISDN specifically. And now you are going to integrate this ISDN, actually this integration of this DDR with this ISDN. So this work in parallel, the work of this ISDN with along with the DDR work efficiently. And you will also learn how to use different commands that are there to identify the analogies in this DDR configurations with the use of again ISDN function and ISDN connection. And in the end of this session, you will be, this is actually the second part where you will be able to use debug commands to identify the analogies in the DDR configurations through again the remote access router and a physical ISDN connection. So this will be the overlook or the brief of today's this lecture. So the first thing that arises anyone's mind is basically, what is this thing that is basically DDR, or you can call it demand or dial on demand routing. So consider a scenario where a user or a customer does not want to any specific or dedicated path or dedicated route for itself, because he is not able to pay the cost for that connection. So he will ask the network to provide him or provide her a temporary path, and this path will be any telephone line or public switch line or any of any form of the network, any form of the lines or cables or even wireless. So this network side will be basically there to provide him a temporary route or temporary path from the transmitter towards the receiver. But how will this network know? Because you see, the network is now becoming a wider and vaster, vast and vast day by day. So how will the network will know that all of these things are in my area or in my region? So this is a very hectic task for even a device. For specifically this function, the concept of this DDR was used. So you will the basic idea behind this DDR is that you will only get a line or a connection or establish, you will only able to establish a connection over a link, and this link will be provided to you on a temporary basis only whenever you have any demand. Whenever you have only you have want to dial something, if it means you have something to send. Dial doesn't mean dialing audio call or video call, it means you have to send something. So you will be able to transmit on a temporary link or temporary connection from your side towards the receiver. But for this purpose, you need to have a coordinator, and this coordinator will be there who will be keeping all of the links, information that will be generated along different paths of the network. And using that information, he will provide you a specific path, a dedicated path for small period of time. So in short, if I have to summarize this demand or dial on demand routing, so you can call it that, you can say that dial on demand routing is basically a specific or unique routing technique excuse me, where the connection to a remote site is established only when it's needed. It is not every time that it is there, it is only necessary, and it is only adopted at that time when the transmitter have to send something to a remote connection to a remote site, or if you want to receive something from a remote site. So the router, if the router tries to send out data and if he sees that the connection is off or the link is down, So the router will automatically establish a connection towards the receiver, and the receiver will be nothing but the switch. We will see that what are the main components of this DDR, but the transmitter will establish a connection towards the receiver, and this receiver will not be ultimate receiver, it will be a virtual receiver, or it, you can call it a proxy server or any mid intermediate node, and that node will further make a virtual link again and establish a connection towards the receiver unless and until the data is reached towards the receiver. So after that the connection is established, the transmitter then sends the information, and once the transmission has been sent and all of the transmission on the links have been completed, the connection is automatically terminated or closed. So this is the concept behind this DDR, and this is the most advantage, the thing that basically benefits benefits us from this concept is basically the cost. We are not able to pay the cost for every connection established. You see that the dedicated path is very much costly. So in order to basically reduce the cost, this DDR is basically come into play, and it basically the concept of the cost of this WAN setup is PPM, pay per minute. PPM stands for pay per minute, and this PPM is very very much high even in this DDR. But imagine how much cost we have reduced. Not we, basically the developers of this concept basically have reduced us and help us to reduce the cost of overall networking for which we are going to pay. So in other words, you can see that as you know already, that constant connections are basically more expensive as compared to just adaptive, or you can say dynamic links. So this is the how the introduction is going to be happen. In this diagram you can see that this is your corporate and this is your basically server. Of user is just sitting over here in the Dallas. So these are the basically states name of the US, and if this router wants to send some data to Dallas, he will ask its hub or this corporate sector have to send some data. So corporate sector want to send something data to this Dallas, and this router of or the switch will send the information towards the hub, and hub will already know the paths towards this Dallas and Chicago. So this will follow this path, but this information, how this information is gathered in this hub, actually this is basically the concept of DDR. So first remember one thing, that this DDR is basically not working alone. It is working alone along with this CDP. We have discovered about the CDP. CDP is basically Cisco Discovery Protocol, and there are several versions. We discussed two or three versions, V1, V2, V3, and we also discussed the iOS and how this image file you can create using this iOS setup. So these all things are basically included in this topic. The first and most important thing about this DDR is that this DDR is also Cisco proprietary routing technique, because as I've told you that it is working along with CDP, that is Cisco Discovery Protocol, which is basically Cisco proprietary protocol. Similarly, it is not possible for DDR, so that it is not possible that DDR should not be Cisco proprietary. So if CDP is basically Cisco proprietary and it is working along this DDR, so it means that this DDR, that is dial on demand routing, is also a Cisco proprietary protocol. So it is by default a simple concept. And along with iOS, let's talk about iOS. So most of the people basically ignore this point, but I'll suggest and I will tell you this information, that this DDR basically is not supported by versions like iOS 9, 10, 11. this mostly work on iOS 12 and above regions, above versions of iOS actually. So if you are working on a lower version of iOS, it might be possible that you have some problems. If you have if you are going to have any lab in future, inshallah, in anywhere or even in the campus, you will see that the versions of iOS will be, every time it will be not less than 12 or not even 11, and the iOS version, the CTP version will be 2, because CTP version 2 is the most compatible form of working along with this DDR, that is dial-up demand routing. Another point that came into my mind is that this DDR is not new protocol. This protocol was basically established years ago, and it is still used today because of many reasons. We will discuss that, all of these topics, one by one. So let's go ahead. Now, when do we have to use this DDR? So the concept behind using this DDR is very much simple. Let's say if you have when you have a low volume, or you can say you have a periodic connections when the traffic demands don't dedicate the use of the dedicated line. So if the traffic is basically periodic, you already know that after some time you will be having some data that you will be sending. So how will the router, it means that you need some entity or some body that have to be there every time you want to initiate a connection and every time you close the connection, just to save your cost, your energy, your bandwidth, your resources, your time, and every other thing is included in that. So there should be some entity or any human person or any system developed software that will be doing such things. So DDR is there for you to do such activities. That is why the importance of DDR over the years did not reduce and will not reduce in the future as well, unless and until they come a suitable replacement. So DDR addresses the need of the periodic connections over circuit switch WAN service. So by using this WAN connections only on a need basis, DDR can save you usage cost, your time, your resources. That's again the whole discussion, that using, by the use of the DDR, if you want to save your connections, if you want to save your cost, if you want to save use your resources efficiently, so this DDR will help you to get along to obtain your or to achieve your all of these objectives. So let's talk about the operation or the working principle of this generic DDR routing technique. So there are two parts to an establishing connection with DDR. The first one is basically the physical connection, and the second one is basically the digital connection. So the physical connection basically consists of, you can see that there are cables, there are system, there is a switch, etc. There are many things that are there. So this is basically the physical connection. And the network of all, you can see that there is also a PSTN also connected, that was in the previous diagram. You can see that it was also connected to this PSTN. And the second part, which is also a more important part, that is basically the DDR connection consists, that second part of this DDR connection basically consists of establishing a digital signal. And by this I mean that this is the there is a requirement for anyone to determine that the protocols should be used over that logical system. We have used many protocols, OSPF, and there are several protocols that we have discussed, routing protocol I am telling you, and mostly there is another protocol that we have also discussed, that PPP, point to point protocol. So this PPP is basically a subset, or you can say underlying body under which above which this DDR actually works, the second part actually works. So The PPP link that is used, and this is used by telephone lines, and these links are basically telephone lines, and these links are basically used to send these signals between a computer and a transmitter, or a transmitter towards the receiver, when the desired, whenever desired, and whenever you want to make a connection. So if you want to make a connection, you establish a connection, and you can use this basically diagram, or you can use this concept of DDR. So this also includes the layer 4, layer 4 adds 4th and 5th lines after a use of a predefined RDL period. This connection is disconnected. So after some time, there is a small period of time under which you can transmit, and after that, if the transmission is even not ended, the connection will be discharged and the connection will be terminated. So this is basically for a small period of time. You have to basically take care of the time as well if you want to make or work under a very specific scenario. Most of the static routes are configured between routers to avoid the periodic transmissions over the WAN, and this is basically a costly thing. This is a static routing, but this is a kind of dynamic routing, and dynamic means you also know that we have also discussed about the dynamic thing. Dynamic is basically something that is much more efficient, much more in terms of the reuse of the resources. So the first step in this DDR operation is, the first thing that you have to find is basically the route. You have to find the route. The first step that the DDR do is basically it finds, it routes the to the destination is determined. So it finds you a route or a path towards your destination. The second thing is that packet packets dictate DDR call. So the packets will have to tell that this is a DDR call. That is, it means that we have this DDR enabled. So for this to work, for this step to work, it must be keep in mind, you have to keep in mind that DDR should be enabled, and this DDR is basically a subset, or you can call it a subbody of ODR. ODR was on demand routing, and this DDR is basically dial on demand routing. So there is a small difference on this ODR and DDR. So the first thing that you have to do is that basically you have to configure and then enable your DDR on your router, on your switch, on your network, including your ISDN that was discussed in the previous class. In the next step, basically the dial-in information is looked up in the table that is managed by the hub. So if this is a hub, let's say this is your DCE, so this hub will be checking your destination in its table or in its database. After that, the traffic is transmitted. If this packet is received in DCE and he sees that this connection is already established, and or if not, he will basically establish a connection for you so that your data is basically transmitted over that link. So then the traffic is basically transmitted, and after this, if the time is ended or the traffic is ended, the call will be terminated. So this is a five-step process, and this process will be repeated again and again unless and until you does not disable this DDR. So this DDR, enabling of this DDR makes you makes a huge overhead also. So this is a small you can say limitation or bottleneck for this concept of DDR. So let's go forward. I hope that you have learned about the operation of this DDR. DDR, you can use this, you can also use this DDR both as a primary and as a secondary backup connection. This is mainly used nowadays as a backup connection. So whenever you want to go live and you want to send your data, you can use this DDR connection. As I've told you that this is basically a overhead process, so the connections are basically slow, and the service fees are also negligible depending upon the uptime. You know that I've already briefed you that this mostly works on PPM, that is pay per minute. So mostly the network is burdened due to the overhead cost used because of this packet and this large complex process. So the PPM might be increased in terms of the cost, and your resources will not be that much of efficient. So the bottleneck of this overall concept is the overhead, and because of that overhead there is a small delay, or you can say the latency increases, and due to the increase in the delay your cost also increases because it is PPM, and as you increase your time, is transmission time and your uptime is increased, you will have to bear more cost. So mostly in the US side and the Japan side, the speed is basically 1.5 Mbps, and in the US and in the Europe and Australia it is around 2.48 or 2.048, something like this. We have also discussed this thing in the previous class as well. So this was the end for the first part of the lecture number 14. In this part we have introduced ourselves to the concept of DDR, the introduction, the basics of DDR, the terminologies that are associated with this DDR, that is dial on demand routing, and we also discussed the generic operation of how does this DDR actually works. Before the operation we actually discussed the architecture of the DDR. I hope that you have learned quite a lot. And now the second part is about the configuration of this DDR. I will see you in the second part with the configuration of this DDR, and let's see that how this configuration occurs in this. So if you have any questions, you may write it down with yourself so that you can ask me in the class. I'll see you in the second part. Thank you very much. Allah Hafiz.